tonight. Anybody who knows the usual format of politics in the pub, it's usually two speakers, a break, and a Q&A. But we've got an exhibition as well, because this is about the arts. So we want to honour some of Australia's best artists. How better could you do that than to put their work on a giant screen? We also, for the break, we also have a musical act, a musical interlude. Buck DeBusco, who's representing one of those musicians who lives, average musicians who lives on an annual salary of $10,000 a year. How do they manage? If you can put anything in a 10-gallon hat, that would be great. But we do have some wonderful speakers tonight. Barbara Doran, Cecilia Castro, they've been involved with Sydney College of the Arts. Juanel de la Corpe, she had to go to South Africa. But we do have her work, and we will see her speak. She did speak during those moments where the students tried so hard to battle for Sydney College of the Arts survival. And last but not least of our speakers, we have the delightful but slightly ill tonight, Sarah Hanson-Young, and she has some important things to say to you. Now, the reason I feel that I have a right to speak is because I am a graduate of Sydney College of the Arts. About 100 years ago! And it changed my life. I was in IT, and my God, those were the happiest days of my life. But I want to go back a little bit in history and just do a slight overview. How have we thought about the arts over the year? What has been the state of the arts in the past? And I came to the conclusion that for a long time, Australia has not known what to do with the arts. From Whitlam to Fifield, ministerial portfolios for the arts have been coupled with the environment, Aborigines, assisting the Prime Minister, heritage, sport, tourism, the territories, administrative services, communications, information economy, and information technology. Wow.
And justice in New South Wales.
But that's not actually a portfolio yet. So on the one side, I reflected, it's been classified with things we consider to be in need of protection, and on the other side, with business. In 2010, the arts portfolio was isolated from both. And by the time George Brandis got hold of it, he was able to subject arts production to his personal whim, while Mitch Fifield expressed notions that there are parallels between the arts and the disability sector. Sacha Grisham from the Sydney Morning Herald also pointed out in June last year that Brandis, as arts minister, crippled the Australia Council, the National Library, the National Gallery, Screen Australia, and severely restricted the operation of the ABC. But there's someone here tonight that has been doing something about the ABC. Sarah Hanson-Young. She managed to get a bill passed recently that would stop any slashing of the funding of the ABC. I'd like to You know, we've had Quentin Dempster here last year, and we love our ABC. Also, that scores of arts organisations, including AsiaLink, Australian Design Centre, Australian Experimental Art Foundation, Canberra Contemporary Art Space, and the Centre for Contemporary Photography have been lost. They've lost their Australian funding. So that is really, that indicates to me a state of crisis. Sacha says it is difficult not to come to the conclusion that the Turnbull government has abandoned the arts as a sector where it feels it will never prevail. The Liberals won the previous election lacking an arts policy and feel that they can do the same again. In addition to the impoverished conditions that Australian artists have always endured, the government's proposed new regulations around vet education and capping those vet loans to $10,000 when at the school where I currently lecture, a vet diploma is $18,000. And they were also wanting to limit their funding to eligible courses exclusively to those deemed to provide good work prospects. This will significantly threaten the future of the arts nationwide by cutting it at that level too. So we've had some problems at Sydney College of the Arts and the HEE, I don't like to use acronyms, higher education sector, but also in the more practical vet training, or as some say, VET. So we think that this is indicative of the anti-cultural bias and philistinism of our federal government, and it urgently needs to be countered. We feel the need now to come together against this rising tide of barbarism and give our young artists hope. Unlike our current government, we understand that theirs are among the future-proof careers in tomorrow's world. The arts will exist. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, Doran. I want to say one more thing. This wonderful image that you have seen in the poster, that is Barbara in disguise. She is the artist who supplied the image for our poster.
Thanks, Cathy, and thank you everyone for coming tonight. I hope I can impart tonight the passion that I feel for art. Art is so important to me that it's almost impossible to give words to. So I'm going to try tonight, and I hope I do something to convey why it's important now. And before I go on, I'm going to start with my involvement with this campaign with SEA. I went to uni and studied all kinds of things that weren't related to art, but I have always been an artist, and I have always practiced making things because it gave me something. So last year, having many friends who work in the arts across many different forms of art, I had a feeling that something was going wrong. And that feeling was a bit like a bushfire. I lived on the back of the Blue Mountains in another life home, and there were times when there was fire coming. And before the fire had started, before the smoke could even be seen, you could feel that this was going to happen. So last year, and maybe in the 6 months before that, I felt that something was happening. And then I was working at NIDA, the National Institute for Dramatic Arts, in their new postgraduate program with people who are involved in cultural leadership. And I heard in April last year that there were going to be massive cuts to the arts. And that felt almost like I was going to lose a limb. And I know that that might sound extreme, but it felt really serious. And I started to think, okay, there's something bad happening out here, and we need to do something about it. And if you've been working in the arts, yes, there have been this sense that something bad is coming. You know, it's a difficult, and always has been a difficult climate to work in. But this was a feeling that something worse was imminent. And then, not many months after that, or probably 6 weeks, just after the announcement that there was massive cuts that Peter just talked about, to the arts, known as Black Friday, and this is why I've put this metaphor up here of fire. This is not just a metaphor, it's actually a continuum of how we feel and connect to things. I heard that SEA was getting more or less shut down. SEA is where I study. I finished my studies as a doctorate. And it was the one place where I could bring my experiences as a human being into reality, and I could make them. I didn't have to neutralize them and sterilize them. I could be real. And not only that, I could be real with other people. And I had some of the most stimulating conversations with some of the most smart and thinking people, people of the calibre of Fiona Hall, who are solving these problems that we face on a daily basis through the arts, through art and through making. And it was through making that I became aware that it's not just the doing of the art, it's not the product at the end, it's the making that's important. And I want to talk about that a little bit more in a minute. So when I heard an SEA was being closed, I felt like I had to do something. And then I went and joined the artists of SEA at Sydney University in the first rally. And I went, okay, here's some energy, here's some people who are really feeling something, and we can do something. And then very shortly after that, we realised that we could actually do something that would really send our message out further, and we realised we could do a vigil at the Archibald Forest. We had 1 week to get this together. We had hundreds of people coming on board to make this happen. We had very little money, but we had passion, and we had skills, and we had connections. And these things are created through the process of making art. And these are engendered because of the kinds of relationships that we encounter by making art and by being artists. So within 1 week, we staged a vigil that was not only, in my mind, a very creative response to a serious problem, but we sent that message out across Australia. We tapped into the media and we sent an image that ended up going out across the world. That image reached London, it reached the Tate. So I just want to acknowledge that in 1 week we could do what I've worked in advertising too, by the way. What advertising agents with lots and lots of money and lots of time and lots of personnel couldn't have done. So this is, first of all, artists can do all kinds of things. And we are resourceful and we are resilient, and I'll keep plugging that one tonight. So one of the things that I think that we are dealing with is this story out there about what makes for a healthy society. And we are continuing with, as Cathy flagged, that this sort of unknown idea of what, sorry, I'm bumping around here. This what is the arts? What is it for? Is it valuable? Is it not valuable? And you know, they call this the culture wars. It comes in and out. They fund it. They don't fund it. But we don't really, we haven't got the nuts and bolts of what it is that arts does, I think, in a way that helps us to really lock it down and say you can't do without this. And this is part of this embedded in the kind of story we're telling about who we are and what we are and what makes us healthy and what kind of quality of life we live. And this is all about efficiency. So one of the things that made SEA be shut down was the economic model that the university was crunching. And we were being charged for space. And we were being charged really for time as well. We were taking up too much. And we weren't yielding income in the way that they were measuring it. And they were saying that enrollments were dropping, but in fact, enrollments in many institutions in the arts were actually increasing. So it really just didn't measure up to their model of what is valuable. And I want to talk a little bit about that. I want to first of all talk about stories, because I want to say that we are all storytellers, and every day we are reenacting our story, and we have to sit back and think about what is that story doing to us. And this is one of the things that I think art does for you. It helps you sit back for a moment, because there are moments of calm, there are moments of time and space where you can say, this is working, isn't it? Can I fix it? Can I fix it? Is this true? Is this real? It's not about do, do, do. If you do, do, do all the time, you don't have time to stop, to think, to ask yourself, is this, am I in balance? And the story out there, on one hand, is that we have to do, do, do,
And this is how we make ourselves healthy, and this is how we make ourselves happy. And then there's another story, that we need downtime, we need time to reflect, we need time to connect, we need time to make. And these are the sorts of things that happen when we are making art. So in the world of economics, the kinds of things that happen in art making are very similar to parenting, or to the kinds of things that are the concerns to environmentalists and anyone who's concerned about our long-term sustainability. They're things that are considered in the world of economics as externalities. We don't measure them. They're not valuable, but they are. So if you don't look after yourself, you might be able to do in a small window of time, but then you might be sick. If we don't have fresh air, how can we breathe properly? We don't measure the fresh air. We measure all the things that we do to build our societies, but we don't look at what the long-term effects are of what we do. So one of the things that are ignored in the process of making art is what it does for us as human beings, and what it does for us as a society, how it connects us to living in a long-term, sustainable way that is meaningful. And I really, really believe this from the bottom of my heart, that making art helps us to get there. I know that making art builds relationships. I don't want to overly idealize it, but it builds relationships in a way that is different. We know that playing sport builds relationships, but there is a different kind of quality that happens when we're making art. It's calm, it's quiet, it's open, it's restful. And I'm not talking about looking at the art, it's the making of the art. Art making is not easy. It takes time, it takes effort, it wrestles with you, you make mistakes, but you learn a kind of quality of character that helps you to endure problems, to be questioning, to be open, to think, how else could I approach it? So this is a quality of adaptivity. It's an evolutionary quality. And again, it's something that you have to have time to be able to do. So I like to think of it a bit like the process of perfection and beauty and balance and the balance of ratios. So each time we do something, we tweak it a little bit. We go, okay, I didn't do that quite right. How can I get it right next time? And it's not something that is an analytical and a heavy respect. And this is why I wanted to talk about the feeling. And the feeling is not just an emotional thing. It's actually something that is in your hands, in your skin, in your body, in your sense. Anyone who's played sport will know that you know, or anyone who's done anything with their body, I think we all know it actually. But we don't give it value. We don't recognize it. We don't say, okay, hang on a minute, this is actually just as important about what I know in my head as what I don't know as a whole living human being. So this is why in our time of economic efficiency, jobs and work, it's really important, especially as time speeds up. And as my taxi driver said tonight, I don't even mind if there's a war, because I think it would be good if technology got blown up pretty severe. But he's saying time has sped up so much that nobody knows where they're at. Technology's taken over our lives. And I'm not a lot of by any means. I don't like technology. And I think it can be part of that process, but it has to happen in time. And we have to have space. And right now I feel like it's encroaching on almost every moment of our working day. So for many years I have pursued this question of what is it about art that not only makes me feel calm and connected, not only makes me enjoy relating to people, but also on an academic, theoretical, scientific level. Is there any information out there that helps me to understand this sense that I have? And it's only within the last 10 to 15 years that we have started to get some information about this. And neurobiology is actually providing us with some maps that show what's going on inside our bodies and our brains. And now we can start to say, this stuff that we feel actually is real. We can see it. So one of my favourite neurobiologists, his name is Antonio De Monte, he says, art is actually an ecological act. It's part of our cultural capacity to respond to the time that we live in, to the circumstances that we live in. And if we don't have it, then we're missing out on a feedback loop. So as a society, as a system that has really a structure of governance that is far better than many other places in the world, and right now we can see what can happen if governance is shot, we have to demand from the people around us that are making decisions about how we live and how the money is spent, that this cultural survival ability that we have is given time and space, is given the money and is recognised. And the thing about it is that it is mostly non-verbal. It is not something that we get ideas about. We almost resist it because we feel it. And this is one of the biggest problems that has plagued art, is that artists know what they feel it, they sense it. How do you talk about it? I'll make a picture, I'll show you. It's not maths, it's not metrics, it's not easy to demonstrate, particularly in terms of modern engineering. The other little bit, this is one of my favourite bits of neurobiology, is that when we've mapped art and we've measured the hormones in our bloodstreams, and we put probes on our brain and go, okay, what's going on? We make oxytocin. Looking at art, even in art galleries, makes oxytocin. Making art makes oxytocin. This is the bonding hormone. It kicks in from the moment you are born. And in fact, if you look at the work with evolutionary biologists, they'll say artification is built into the way that we learn. The moment I look at you and go, hello to my little baby boy, he responds. We are wired to artify our world, to make it surprising, and then to repeat so that we learn. And all of this is wired in with oxytocin. So, art making makes oxytocin. It builds these bonds. So these bonds that I talked about in relationships, the feeling of calmness that comes over us, actually has evidence, if you want evidence. And we should remember this as a society. So this is just a reiteration of what I've said. We bring into the world the stories that we make. We make them come alive. And you can make any story come alive. But we need to think about what is that story doing to us. And the story that is happening to us right now is one that is going to ask us to become like automated robots, where we work, ever connect, and we don't have time for each other. Or the kind of things that we make are so clinical and so devoid of soul and connection that there will be nothing to motivate us. There will be no meaning. I want to re-emphasize also that artists work with materials. They work with glass. They work with clay. They work with wood. They work with paint. They work with canvas. They work with each other, with instruments, with sound. These are non-verbal things, that they are all the things that make us know that we are alive. How would we know we were alive if we did not have a material experience? If we could not hear, if we could not touch, if we could not make, if we could not connect. So art is where we bring this to life. And artists are the ones who spend extra time listening, watching, feeling, responding, and sharing their observations, telling their stories. So if we don't have this, what have we got? So just in summary, I would say that the arts are actually the building blocks of society, of culture. They help us to cooperate, not compete, to adapt to the circumstances that we have, and mind that we have some pretty challenging things at us. And I don't think I need to rename what they are. I think we all know them and hear them over and over and over again in this world that is consumed with information. I just want to remind us that inside of that, we need to be inquisitive and the arts are playful. They invite us to move on, to imagine, to find fresh ideas. They invite us to experiment. What if I do this? And I was reminded the other day that there is no new invention in the world from the sciences that has happened through cerebral deduction alone. In other words, by theory and theory alone. It has always involved making, experimentation with materials. So if you want to solve problems in the world, make things. Hearts are open. They're accepting. They want to find a way to engage. It's not about being closed. There are times when it is useful to be directed, but most of the time we need to be inquiring about the world and we're in a state of curiosity and openness. Artists are collaborative, not necessarily competitive. And artists are incredibly resourceful. I have read many books that say artists are the ultimate entrepreneurs. If you want to get something done, you want to have someone who can make something out of very little, come and get artists in the group because that's what they know how to do. And I don't want to necessarily dismiss that, and I don't want to necessarily make that into something that's, because this has been something that has been exploited in the arts. People go, okay, well, artists will do this for free, they're resourceful. There's not a reason to exploit artists, it's actually a reason to value artists. I like it. We want to get onto our Facebook page. I'm a member of, or I'm actually the chair of Friends of SCA, and so you can register there and just even by being a member, you're backing us. But I also would like you to jump onto the NABA website page. And I'll give you the address in a minute because at the moment they have a very important petition, and the petition is about making sure that artists are paid for what they do, that artists, unlike other professions, are not left out of the loop. Sorry, I'll read further. Artists so often have no super. We just get short-term projects and we get paid, if we get paid at all, and then we have nothing ongoing. So there is a request in this super, in this petition that artists are paid super, and there is also a request that artists who most often are working, or very often working, with an income that is below the poverty line, that's just how externalized they are, their income is supplemented. So these are three very important things for bringing artists up at a very basic level that is comparable and expected by most people in our society. When I say our society, Australian society. So if you'd like to get onto the NABA web page, I'm just going to give you the address. It's visualarts.net.au. And if you want to find out that address again, come and talk to me.